Art, design and style are a language in images, a method by which humans can communicate ideas, express conceptions about themselves and the society and community in which they live. 6,000 years before the Christ event, progressive societies around the world shared a basic prerequisite. They needed to develop an ability to emerge from the hunter-gatherer stage by producing enough food to free up some people from tilling the fields. Then they could devote time to other pursuits, including establishing early forms of government. They developed a written vocabulary to accumulate ideas and knowledge about the traditions they had established. This facilitated the administration of agriculture, animal husbandry, public works, and other communal activities, which were essential to establishing urban life. Recording past experiences assisted them to continually refine their knowledge, so they would be able to expand their horizons while securing the future of their culture and its people. Much of early world history is dominated by the rise and fall of great empires, interspersed with invasions and periods of anarchy. However, eventually religion, literature and government, as well as its visual art forms, define the character and individuality of each civilization. Since ancient times, post and lintel construction has been a successful method of building. From Stonehenge in England to Luxor in Egypt, to Knossos on Crete, and on to Athens in Greece, and finally Rome in Italy, the architectural remains of former precincts of power and glory, ruined or otherwise, offer us an invaluable insight into our ancestors' distinctive achievements. The ancient Egyptians created a civilization that lasted over 3,000 years. At Thebes, the ceremonial capital on the west bank of the Nile, they developed a remarkable knowledge of astronomy, engineering, mathematics, and medicine. They also established an organized taxation and legal system with a police force and courts. Women had more legal rights than in some countries today. They wore fine clothing and chose from a wide range of cosmetics and beauty products. We owe our calendar of 365 days to the ancient Egyptians, who divided the day and night into 24 hours. They were truly amazing. Nearly all primitive peoples on Earth developed an intoxicant to help them face the often harsh realities of life. Alcohol was one of the most pleasant of all the benign poisons that we use. It was made from the fruit of the Vitis vinifera, the famous grapevine of Europe and the Middle East, which was one of the first plants ever domesticated. Wine was to be enjoyed in moderation, in an air of conviviality, celebration and community. It wasn't considered hospitable by your peers to overindulge. The advent of sophisticated irrigation farming techniques meant that higher crop yields, supporting a greater concentration of people, became possible. At first, towns were born, and eventually cities. Architecture is a product of society and the art of enclosing space. In ancient Greece, cities had innovative town planning. Streets were laid out in a gridiron pattern designed to aid the flow of cleansing winds. They ranged out from the main public buildings and agora, or marketplace, which was the focal point for city life. The houses that developed turned their back on the street, looking inward to a courtyard, which was the focus for home life in a temperate Mediterranean climate. The city was mostly fortified or had a necropolis, a high place where citizens would retreat in times of trouble. Governments were either an oligarchy, where only a few people held the balance of power, or a democracy, where government was made through decisions made by citizens appointed on behalf of the common good. The Greek style of post and lintel architecture respected the sensibility and intelligence of ancient man. Its parts were all unified, and there is no mystery, muddle or confusion, just superb stone buildings whose huge columns brought order and a sense of strength stability and security. The fundamental difference between our society today and those of ancient times is that practically everyone had a direct link to agricultural production, whether they lived in the city or the country. As fertility is virtually synonymous with survival, it doesn't take much imagination for us to endeavour to understand why there are allusions to everything associated with the act of procreation in surviving wall paintings, or why they had so many different gods and deities that were of the heavens and earth. The encounter between Roman and Greek Hellenistic art resulted in an enthusiastic appreciation of beauty as an end in itself. On a wall painting in a villa in the excavated 1st century Roman town at Pompeii in Campania, Italy, the Roman goddess Flora is beauty personified, appearing as an integral aspect of its life and many legends. She walks gracefully, the lower part of her chiton wafting on a gentle breeze, expressing a sense of joyful freedom and harmony with nature, one that we associate with the ancient Roman civilization at its best. Her turned head indicates that what is concealed may yet be more beautiful. It also suggests that which is not revealed cannot ever disappoint. This intellectual idea transposed into architectural philosophies of the period. A vista in architecture was meant to reveal itself slowly and as a surprise, just like Flora's beauty. It is important to clarify the use of the word legend, because some may be fearful we're suggesting a lack of truth. Originally, a legend was generally understood to be an illustrative story, one designed to convey a profound spiritual truth in an attempt to explain that which could not be explained, that which was inexplicable. In the Greek world, while the emphasis was on thought and art, in the Roman world, creative engineering was its greatest achievement. 7 Etruscan kings first ruled Rome. Their culture occupied central Italy from 750 to 200 years before the Christ event. They were great builders who learned much from the Greeks. They developed construction techniques that included the arch, the vault, irrigation, land drainage, and sewage. They were not conquered, but eventually merged with the Romans, who were a robust, virile society, an ambitious people for whom family life was at the heart and soul of its culture. The Romans approached all the challenges in their lives in a practical manner. They solved them by the creative use of ideas. These were often borrowed from other cultures that they conquered. One of their biggest contributions to the evolution of architecture was the invention of a revolutionary material, concrete. It was invaluable for vaulting or pouring into a shape to suit the curves and awkward junctions which arise in creating vaulting. The Pantheon, built 120 to 124 years after the Christ event, still stands at Rome today. It is a domed circular building on a very large scale, demonstrating the superiority of Roman construction. By using concrete for support and to provide a coffered form of vaulting, the builders could make its dome light in construction. Because of increasing incursions into Roman territory by other peoples from the north, Constantine made the ancient city of Byzantium, sited on the Bosporus, the capital of his all-new-look Roman Empire. It conveniently straddled the east and west. The Byzantine architect discovered a method for supporting a round dome on a square base. In Byzantine architecture, a dome symbolized the heavens, and because Christ was now believed to be ruler of the universe, he was depicted in mosaics made from glass and many different stones. They offered far greater flexibility than any other decorative medium. Following the sacking of Rome by Alaric the Visigoth and his tribe in the year 410, the sands of time and a veil of legends fell over that former great intellectual, political, and artistic capital of the ancient world. Its citizens fled to the safety of the hills, and the city fell into ruinous decay. In medieval Europe and England from the 5th to the 15th century, many different cultures were battling invasion by others. Society became divided into three separate class structures: the priests who stayed at home and prayed, the noble and his knights who went to war, and the peasants who worked the fields to provide the food for everyone else. Europe's social equilibrium depended on these three groups coexisting happily and staying in their allotted places. Taking vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience helped determine a pattern for medieval culture. During this period, towns in the true sense of the word ceased to exist, with fortified castles and the protection of a lord under a feudal system the only security for everyone. Defence was considered far more important than comfort. The medieval lord was responsible for the safety and well-being of all who lived within his household. It was essentially a large extended family, one in which everyone had an acknowledged place. In England and Europe, the Great Hall became the centre for all activity. At first, everyone gathered around a central hearth for eating, sleeping, dining, and enjoying everyday life. As education and literacy gradually became important, a modicum of privacy for the lord and his immediate family was required. They withdrew into a suite of private chambers where comfort and convenience became a concern. Medieval craftsmen achieved high standards and levels of accomplishment. The mortise and tenon joint was a significant invention that allowed for green timber to move, revolutionising timber construction. In 1414, while accompanying the Pope on a visit to a Benedictine monastery, historian Poggio Bracciolini discovered a handbook about the ancient Roman system of education. In the same year, Poggio made another important discovery, an ancient architectural manuscript. From then on, a succession of popes directed the search for ancient manuscripts and had their scribes copy and translate texts. Knowledge, they knew, was power. And now we'll take a break and come back with part 2 of the evolution of art, design and style.